पेर पेटाड़गा
Yes, sir, you are telling something?
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much and good morning to you all, sir. The thing what we are supposed to do as a faculty, we are all doing from other side. Definitely, thank you for filling that gap and respect you all to have this type of approach towards this academician, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. On behalf of AAA department, be very in our support. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Yeah, so this is the objective of today's program of 2 hours. So it is planned to list out all the major electrical players or equipment, right from generation to utilization through renewables, smart appliance, T&D, protection, switchgear, microgrid, EVs, and safety. I will touch to review the latest developments in all the above listed fields towards either green energy or energy savings for sustainable growth, to identify the gaps. Because of these developments, definitely there are gaps. Earlier also there were gaps, now also gaps are getting created. Every time, whenever there is a new thing, definitely there will be a gap that we will see. And to find out opportunities existing for researchers to do research to fill the gaps and the entrepreneurial opportunities in the present era of modern electrical engineering field. So it is customary to see that from the left side, it is for the Ratan Tata, what he told towards the entrepreneurship, always been very confident and very upbeat about the future potential of India. I think it is great country with great potential. Yes, it is by great Tata. Then the right side bottom is by our great scientist Einstein. Once you stop learning, you start dying. This has inspired me a long back. Even though I am busy with my industrial activities of motor, transformer, cable and day-to-day problems, I used to update myself regularly, whenever the time permits, early hours or night hours, I used to sit and learn and I used to see what is going on. Otherwise, I might have stuck up in the generator old era only. This microgrid, smart grid, electrical equipment, artificial intelligence, I may not be knowing. So continuously, I'm updating myself and trying to impart to the down level. And today's pre-lunch menu, so this program will continue to up to lunch. So free lunch menu, it is not food or anything. It will be the thing is seen here, bookworms. They are eating the book.
Sorry for the disturbance. Sir, you are visible only for the first slide only, sir. Welcome slide only, it's visible.
Not visible?
Yes, yes, sir. Welcome slide only, it's visible, sir.
Yeah, one minute.
Welcome to yes, present, it's okay. Present topic.
I will come back again, yeah.
Yes, yes, sir.
Is it okay, sir, now?
It's not there, sir. Your desktop only, your computer only showing, sir. Just a double click for this one.
Yeah.
Gap and opportunities for...
You have made me presenter and I am
seeing... Yes, already. Both given for the presenter, sir. Presenter option given for both.
Yeah, you have given me both. Whether that is creating trouble, I am verifying.
Yes.
Is it okay now?
Yeah. Yes, it's okay, sir. You move to the next slide, sir.
Coming?
No. First slide only, it's available, sir. Welcome to HTTP on. To press for the PowerPoint presentation, if you check for the PowerPoint presentation.
Yeah, actually my desk is... Shall I close the other one?
Yes. Presently, its objective is there, sir. Objective.
Is coming?
Yes. Present topics. Objectives, yes, sir, it's changed. It's nice, sir. It's
now,
okay,
Tata
sir.
Tata is coming. Tata and
yes, yes, sir. Yes, Tata is coming, sir.
Yeah. So now
today's pre-lunch menu. Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, okay, sir. You continue, sir.
Pre-lunch menu is not food. It is a book or knowledge. The book is showing with occupied with bookworms on the left side. So they are eating the book. I am also trying to tell something. Introduction. What is modern electrical power? What is then I will start going the trying to about explain the about the equipment, turbo generators, renewable energy like solar, wind, and fuel cell, transmission AC, DC, and FACTS, microgrids and LVDC, deregulation, transformers. I will continue up to the last. 14th is computer-aided study in the power system, HRD, then miscellaneous. So now, introduction. Today we cannot imagine the human life without electricity. Even a minute we cannot tolerate. It is must. With the advancement of technology and faster penetration of PEDs and computers, power system has seen a lot of changes since its invention. These changes have improved the system efficiency, increased the share of renewables or green energy or energy savings, and made the control system very easy, but with some challenges. The evaluation of distributed generation, microgrids, smart grids, electrical vehicles, FACTS and drives have made the system complex too. It is complex because of cybersecurity threat, optimum power allocation demands, harmonic mitigation, reactive power management, etc. And at the same time, there are opportunities to do research to fill the gaps and continual improvement and business opportunities. So an attempt is made here now by me to review the recent developments, challenges, and the opportunities for researchers and entrepreneurs. So what is modern power electrical system compared with earlier? Now the modern power system is with generation of conventional and non-conventional, distributed generation, transmission distribution with the HVDC, EHVDC, and flexible AC transmission FACTS. Now with the load side, there are so many smart devices which are communicating with each other as well as with the parent company or manufacturer, electrical vehicles, smart grid, microgrid, and IoT, safety, control system, a lot. Of course, HRD is important, human resource development is important, auditing is a must in energy as well as safety, the maintenance practices, the utilization of softwares, standards and codes to be followed, and the power deregulation, they're also very important. So this is the basic idea, what I thought today to explain, starts from TZ, the transformer, the lines, protection, the measurements part, and the transformer, how it is, distributed generation, wind turbine, photovoltaic arrays, VFDs, and the storage devices like battery, and the consumption side, HVAC, electrical vehicle, lighting, everything I want to touch. And now I am going straight away to the conventional generators, or the old traditional turbo generators having a stator and rotor with a cooling of either water or hydrogen up to 500 megawatt. Now we have supercritical turbo generators of 800 megawatt. Now it is under developmental stage of 1300 MVA TZs. So the TZ market is expected to see a compound annual growth rate, CAGR, of around 3.8 between 2020 and 25. Even though penetration of renewables are coming up, but definitely these maintain their around 4%. The CAGR, what it is, and then now research is going towards cryogenic cooling in place of existing practice of liquid or hydrogen cooling, because now superconductors at earlier of minus degrees temperature, now at a 0 degree temperature, superconductors are coming up now where the resistance is zero, copper loss or I square R will be zero, so we will have only magnetic losses. The efficiency will be going to touch 99%. But the problems are special cooling of maintaining at 0 degree centigrade or minus side, it is required as on date. Mostly the superconductors are used for rotor winding as shown in the figure. It is used so that we can maintain almost a zero resistance. But the problem is cooling. At lowest level, it shall be cryogenic cooling with the help of liquid nitrogen it is required. So the main advantage will be reduced losses, improved efficiency. But what are the gaps here? This is the way what I am going to explain today. The gaps in this TG is cost of cryogenic cooling and its maintenance, because leakage chances are there. Slow responding speed governors. As on date, the turbines, steam turbine or Hedel turbine, the governor response rate, even though they are digital nowadays, the response rate is not that much like a wind gale or a cloud. How the cloud is moving fast, getting changed from zero to total cloud or coming out back. In the same way, the excitation response ratio of generator, the speed governor shall act in that way. Definitely there is a gap in this area. We have to find out the best fast responding exciter for turbo generators, then things will be made very easy. Also, the speed governor should be digital with the fastest possible time. The speed should be adjusted based on the demand. So the gap again is lack of skilled people in turbo generator side of excitation and governor. We don't have much experts. It is required. And the coal-based thermal power plants, as on date, most of the things, more than 50 or 60% is coal-based power generation only, where the efficiency is 35 to 40 hardly. It should be improved. And TG capacity is nowadays touching 1300 MVA. It should go beyond 1500. So these are the gaps. Wherever, whoever wants research can do like this. Find out alternate cooling system to the present hydrogen or water cooling. There should be an alternate system that can be done through research. Digital speed governors, digital voltage regulators. Of course, we have DVRs now in market, digital voltage regulator, but they are not up to the mark. Still, they should be fast enough, and utilization of artificial intelligence in turbo generators research can be done. And business for the new people or startups or entrepreneurs, RLA study, residual life assessment of turbo generators, a big field having lot of opportunities. And I know the people in this field are very, very less, because we have three number of 30 megawatt turbo generators, coal based, we have in our plant. We are getting to get the expert people to do this job once in 5 years. So definitely there is a chance to do RLA study by starting a company. And condition monitoring of turbo generators, the people are less in the market, to analyze what is the field current, what is the response ratio, what are the harmonics in the waveform, or what is the vibration of generator and turbine. Condition monitoring, it can be done. Nothing but health checkup of a turbine generator system like a human. Master health checkup to be done for this. Number of players available as on date in market is less. There are some people who are doing practically, but they don't have practical theoretical background. They don't know what is the excitation response ratio, and they don't know what is the curve between frequency and load. If they know that and practically, then they can do a good job. So we do not have people right now. That's why opportunity is existing for technical people of undergraduates and postgraduates of EEE department to do this job. Performance analysis, whenever equipment is installed, performance appraisal, annual appraisal, like that. We are conducting exams every 6 months or yearly to the students to know the performance or to evaluate them. Similarly, any equipment in field taking some input like coal or water, giving out something in the form of electricity, their performance should be monitored regularly. That is important. Where it is lagging, people are not there in the market to do this business. And retrofits. Since now in our plant, we have governor of manual mode. We want now digital governor. Retrofit, remove the old and fix the new. It is the confidence. There should be a people who should come out, clarify our doubts. They have to assure that nothing will went wrong if it is a retrofit. They have to convince us, remove the old part, put the new part, show the improvement. So that is the business existing in TGs. Sir, my PPT is changing. Sarvan sir or madam, my weather
is changing? Yes, sir.
Okay. So now the next one is renewable energy resource or non-conventional generation. So now there are expectations universally to harness energy from all panchabhutas. Panchabhutas, the five great elements as per our Hinduism, the sky, the earth, the fire, water and the air. Fire, geothermal energy experiments are going on. I am happy to inform you that the nearby we have Sengareni collieries, 10 kilometers away from me. Recently, they have started one project of geothermal 20 kilowatt capacity at the cost of around 2 crores. They have started this project. So geothermal has to pick up because we have a lot of potential in this. This may be the future coming energy for the world because whether it is wind or solar, there are so many problems. Geothermal definitely will not have any problem. Only thing you have to dig out and take out the energy from the earth, from the depth of 3 kilometer or 10 kilometer, where we can go and catch it, the fire. And earth coal already we are consuming, and we have consumed our share. And whatever we are consuming today is not ours. It is our children's share we are consuming today, the coal. That's why this fossil fuels utilization should be reduced. Air, wind turbines are there, but have so many problems. Water, hydro power we have, which is seasonal based, and solar, sky. So there is a lot of demand to harness all these panchabhutas to get the power for the world, human. And now, the latest development in renewable energy is floating solar farms. Because you know, the solar, to have 1 kilowatt, to have 1 megawatt, we are taking around 3 to 4 acres of land. Maybe fertile land, sometimes it is being used. The solar floors, use them. We are using already solar skins and tiles for the roofs. Flexible solar panels for ground mounted, which can be flexible, it can be folded also. Solar fabrics, which will generate power required for the self, like a mobile phone with a t-shirt, it can be done. Smart inverters, nowadays they are coming up. They will monitor and diagnose the PV system and suggestions to reduce the operation and maintenance cost. Smart inverter. As on date, the inverters earlier were power conditioning units only. Now smart enough, still some more thing is to be done here. Anti-solar panels, night time, the radiation effect from the ground, which is emitting back the heat, can be used for the modules. That is anti-solar panel, we can get the energy there. And portable solar units, nowadays they are there on electrical vehicles, vehicle to grid. There are so many developments are going on here, but what are the gaps? Now the demand from all sides to harness the and increase the power conversion efficiency. Wind is, as on date is 35 to 40, which should be increased beyond 50. Solar as on date is 17 to 18. There are so many claims that they are touching 25, 30, but practically not done. So the solar PV efficiency is to be improved. And SPVs, gaps are module maintenance. We are lagging, we are not doing properly. The lightings are natural calamities. They are affecting the solar modules, animals and bird droppings, grid interconnection. Power evacuation is a problem because the solar is intermittent. Since it is not consistent or constant, at the other end, people are not ready to take the solar power because it is not continuous or constant. And skilled manpower experts are not there in solar field as on date. Also, the harmonics and reactive power management is a must. Anti-islanding function of PV system is there, but still it is not up to the mark. And PV field or renewable energy requires a lot of investment or money, where the return is less, return on investment or ROI or payback is very, very high of beyond 10 years. So there is a gap. It should be reduced or should have special funding arrangement for this. And wind turbine, noise and aesthetic pollution. Definitely wind turbines are giving noise, which should be reduced. And also the cost should be reduced with improved design and reliability. And we know wherever there are wind turbine giving sound and all, the local wildlife is getting affected, which the environmentalist will not accept. Wind turbines are away from the load centers. We know load centers are mostly cities or urban areas, whereas wind turbines are far away. So the transmission of power supply again is a headache or job to be done. And the bed and foundation issues of wind turbine is very, very serious issue. The design is up to the mark. It should withstand for wind gales of above 100 kmph also it should withstand, and earthquakes and all of scale, Richter scale of up to 6 also they should be able to withstand, where things are to be done a lot. So there is a gap definitely in that. And the grid integration issues, definitely it is there. We have to integrate with the grid and we have to export the power with the proper agreement. And immature fuel cell technology. As on date, we have fuel cells, but they are not up to the mark because the durability, how much time it will, at least if it is a solar module, we can say now the life is around 25 years. Wind also, we can claim 20 to 25 years. Whereas the fuel cell, we do not know the durability. A lot of research is going on, still it is required. Because if you take the reliability of a fuel cell, now that we have internal combustion engine or diesel or petrol engine for our vehicles or other things, we have a lifespan of 2 lakh kilometers or 5,000 running hours, and they will work satisfactorily up to 80 degrees centigrade. Whereas fuel cells, we do not know the performance, their life, shelf life, and the temperature up to which they will work. So thermal and water management also must, because as on date, wherever the today there is no industrial person in the participants list, or maybe somebody. So improve the PV module efficiency beyond 20% and go for new materials. We know as on date, whatever the material we are having, gallium, arsenide, or germanium, silicon, they are non-biodegradable and toxic in nature, mostly. So the PV module nowadays requires regularly cleaning, dust blowing and all. They should be maintenance free, or self cleaning facility they should have with the robotic system or something. And our research can be done. A robot will go in the morning hours, wherever the dust it has to identify, it should clean. That is required. It can be done. Flexible modules with longer life. As on that, flexible modules are working for 5 years only. And definitely we should use IIoT, Industrial Internet of Things, for maintenance purpose. And the drives as on date are there giving harmonics of 4 to 5%. They should be less or less than 3% as prescribed by ITV. As mentioned, the robotics should be used in maintenance. Also, artificial intelligence can be used in maintenance. And better grid management and anti-islanding techniques. As on date, research is going on. Still, it is required, particularly in the area of anti-islanding techniques. And improved maximum power point tracking is also to be done. So far, we have some 4 or 5 techniques. Cost reduction. 10 years back, when we were thinking of to go for solar, we have seen 1 megawatt costing 20 crores. And in 2013, we have gone for a solar of 12 megawatt. The cost was 10 crores for 1 megawatt. Now I am hearing it is 4 crores per megawatt. Should come down further, the improvement. It should be 1 crore per 1 megawatt. Then only it will be reasonable. So it should come down with the research. Definitely it will come down. And we can think of the power from walkways and staircase. We can generate a minimum amount of energy, which is sufficient for the light up of the staircase or walkways, or charging the mobile phone or cameras. That is enough. And the business, operation and maintenance work of solar modules or other areas, performance analysis, whenever we are putting some money and installing the power plant of wind turbine or solar or coal or anything, there should be analysis, annual evaluation to be done. Now we have standard formulas like performance ratio, capacity utilization factor, annual yield, like that. We have so many formulas given by IEC, but there are less people in the market available as on date to do performance analysis of renewable energy resources, particularly solar. So there is an opportunity. And remote monitoring of plants by sitting at a city, with an app or something, or by connecting with IoT or IIoT, definitely we can monitor so many power plants, like vehicles, what is going on as on date. I know the Reliance Jio, all their towers throughout the country are getting monitored at a central place in Delhi or Mumbai. They are doing, and wherever there is a problem, they are sending the nearest team for attending it. Definitely, similar way, in a region, a person can do a business by having agreement with those people, monitor it, maintain it. Energy and financial audit. Definitely, auditing to be done towards energy. What is the input and what is the output, and financial? What is the return on investment? How things are going on? Is it profit or loss? Of course, in renewable energy, initial days, there will be definitely loss only. No question of profit. Maybe after 5 years, there is a chance of profit. The break-even period of solar may be around 5 years. So locally we do not have. There should be a player who can supply spares instantly. JIT is the word used in Japan nowadays. Just in time, JIT. The spare, whatever I want, I will take out the model, I will give a photograph of nameplate. It should come to me within a day. Spares supply, there is lagging, we are here. It should be available. And there is a financial opportunity funding the new projects with a reasonable interest rate and heat recovery from fuel cells for HVAC application. We know whenever we are running fuel cells, the heat is the byproduct, water is the byproduct. This heat, whether we can use for heating, ventilation and air conditioning systems, even a vehicle where we are driving, the output of fuel cell, the heat can be used for air conditioning of the car. There is a chance for business. Retrofit the existing vehicles with a fuel cell and air conditioning. That will solve. And e-waste disposal, whether it is a solar or wind or fuel cell, definitely after some time, the waste, whatever coming out, is not a biodegradable electronic waste. Disposal as on date, I know for entire Telangana and Andhra, we have only one or two companies in Hyderabad who are taking. Of course, the user has to pay and he has to give his waste. He cannot throw simply here and there. There are so many laws and rules and regulations. So e-waste disposal is a big business. And coming to the transmission, AC, DC, and the combination, flexible AC transmission system. This is the graph, what I'm showing here. So up to 1940s, my pen is giving trouble. So up to 1940s, we have around the voltage levels. If you see this graph, number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Number 3 is of 287 kV in USA in 1932 itself. But India, it took a lot of time to come out. And later on, so now experiments are going on nowadays. For if you see the right type, right side, HV, the range is 100 to 230, maximum length is only 200 kilometer. EHV, we have 800 kV, now we have 800 kV AC, 765 AC lines, the length is maximum of 1000 kilometers. UHV, ultra high voltage, above 800, experiments are being done for 1200 kV. Once Russia has done for 1100 kV, but later on they have stopped Now India, we have done experiment in two years back in Madhya Pradesh, Bina, for 1200 kV of 1 kilometer length. 1200 kV experiments done in India for AC transmission, but somehow because of the insulator problem that was stopped, again something is going on, and the length can be 1300 kilometers safely without much loss. So the power in kilo megawatt versus the line length, up to 1200 kilometer we can transfer around 5500 megawatt. Later on with the work is going on to transmit electrical power at higher and higher voltage levels to reap the benefit of HV transmission in the form of efficiency as well as losses. And the recent updates like this: China energized its first 1000 kV 650 kilometer long UHV AC demonstration in 2009. Later on, no further development. In India, 1200 kV, whatever I have told you, in Madhya Pradesh it is done. In a DC side, India, we have already constructed and operating 800 kilowatt DC line between Champa and Kurukshetra in 2013 to transfer 3 gigawatts, not a simple thing. China is now developing 1100 kV line for 10 gigawatt power transfer. But this has reported to reduce the right of way by 50% when compared to HVAC. If 1100 kV DC is used, the right of way or the land required beneath the overhead line, if you stand at the center of overhead line on the ground, the left side and right side, maybe 10 meter or 20 meter or 30 meter length will be right of way, which is required for the maintenance purpose, maintenance of movement of vehicles, and to avoid electromagnetic interference, EMI is required. With the DC, it will definitely come down, so the land can be saved. And we have now FACTS, flexible AC transmission system, is on cards, not on cards, somewhere it is going on, with the models of series controllers, parallel controllers, and the combination of series parallel we have. There are so many techniques in FACTS with the help of power electronic devices. These are the developments. And what are the gaps? The land requirement to lay the transmission lines or to go for underground cables, land is required, money is required, capital. And for overhead lines, dense public area, it is not permitted. It should go through rural areas or through forest. Insulator is a big issue, because now 765 kV, we have insulators for 1200 kV. The insulator technology has failed. People are doing research by Crompton and Arriva. They have to come up. There is a gap. And safety for underground cable. Whenever we are putting underground cables beneath the earth, people are going and digging for waterworks or plantation or some other Mission Bhagirath or Mission Kakatiya or some other Sitarama project, people are digging the land, there is a chance of electrocution, and also cables will be affected. And HV testing facility, if we take one 6.6 kV cable or transformer, a 20 kV testing equipment is required. If I take a 220 kV transformer for testing purpose, 1050 kV pulse generator is required. So the testing for 1200 kV, we do not have in the market as on date. And the end user safety is in trouble. So it is a gap. Definitely it should be identified for proper safety protective devices like Corona, what we are seeing. We have PPEs for Corona. Similar way, wherever people are using electricity, the existing safety devices not enough. We require some improvements in this area. And also the power quality, because of the penetration of power electronic devices like thyristors and IGBTs, there is presence of harmonics, nothing but electrical pollution. The sine wave is getting polluted with other waveforms, multiples of sine only, so the quality is getting affected. As on date, with the PEDs, let us take the inverter. As on date, we are getting, in my plant, VFDs, we are getting harmonics of more than 12%. Again, it's the prescribed IEEE limit of 5%. So still some more thing is done in the form of filters to improve the power quality. Harmonics with the power converters in FACTS. Yes, again, flexible transmission system also. This power converters have harmonics. Even a three-level converter, what we are studying nowadays, have harmonics. They should be reduced, particularly triple harmonics. And non-availability of EHV DC circuit breakers. Circuit breakers, circuit breakers. The circuit breakers as on date we have in DCR with a capacitor arrangement to pump back the supply in reverse direction so that the arc can be quenched. But definitely something to be done in this area to have EHV circuit breakers. As on date for UHV AC, problem is insulator. For EHV DC, the problem is circuit breaker. And lastly, biological effects of EHV or UHV. Nowadays, people are claiming wherever people are going nearby the UHV lines or EHV lines, people are getting affected because of the potential grade of so and so kV per meter they are talking. Skin cancer is the ultimate result. Some researchers are claiming there is a chance of skin cancer. So EHV, UHV, definitely there is a gap. Something is to be done to find out something in the form of a shielding or something is required. We have lightning shields to protect the lines as on date, but definitely we should have a shielding system for human as well as nearby equipment and structures. We should have some shielding arrangement. So research is to be done. And the business opportunities in the present era of power system deregulation, transmission and distribution can be an independent system. So we require ISOs, independent system operator. Like a cable TV operator, we should have a transmission operator, distribution operator. In a particular area, in a city, there are 2-3 cable operators. Like that, we should have power system operators who can give power to the house. So there is a chance of business. Of course, it may take some time. Now, again, the research is going on. People are thinking about low voltage DC. Low voltage DC is nothing but as per IEC, up to 1500 volt supply is low voltage. Earlier classification of Indian electricity rules of low voltage, high voltage, extra high voltage are not there now. Now we have voltage bands of 1, 2, 3, 4. Now we are talking about low voltage DC because now research is going on. I hope IEC recently has told LVDC is the power of 21st century, definitely, because solar we are getting DC of 35 volt for module like that. Keep 3 module in series, we will get 100 or 110 volt DC, enough to feed the house. In ESA, as on date, the voltage, domestic voltage is 120 volt or 110 volt AC only. Similarly, in future, we can have LVDC, where we can directly use the solar PV modules for the load, so we can avoid inverters and also the safety. Because of 110 volt DC, we know right now, from safety point of view, 50 volt AC is dangerous beyond 50, and beyond 120 volt DC is dangerous. So LVDC of 120, the safety is ensured fully. So, and also the batteries are available, 110 volt DC or 120 volt DC, we can store the energy, even the solar energy can be stored in those batteries. So there is a lot of business in coming days for LVDC market. And operation and maintenance of transmission and distribution, there are players, of course, enough players are available. Still, opportunities are existing in this competitive market. And microgrids and LVDC, most of you know what is microgrid. It is a local mini power grid which can operate as a separate small entity or in collaboration with other small grids. By combining small grids of so many microgrids or small grids, it will be a smart grid. So here we have DC source in the form of photovoltaic modules or fuel cells. We have inverters, it goes to AC bus, or even DC can be used directly. AC source, like wind turbine, it goes, and this is a common bus bar where we have AC loads as well as grid connected system. So a microgrid is there. The developments in the latest incorporation of microgrids and consumer levels like commercial establishment and educational institutes. Even the BVRIT having its own solar power plant can have. So actually, unknowingly, BVRIT or myself here, we are operating microgrids. I have a grid, I have a diesel generator, I have a solar power plant. So I have in my plant a microgrid. Similarly, BVRIT having their generator, their PV modules and their grid connection, BVRIT is also operating as a microgrid unknowingly, unstructured way. So by putting proper controls and communication devices, it can be a full-fledged microgrid. Educational institutes definitely shall have this microgrid facility and LVDC system at distribution levels. The challenges, the technical microgrids and distributed generation surplus should go to grid, and whenever we are in need, we should be able to import. And also there are some safety of the human, security of the equipment, and the stability of grid. Triple S, safety, security and stability are the challenges ahead. Opportunities in research side, harmonic less converters we can invent, less than 1% or zero harmonic converters or inverters are required. Power quality should be improved. Integration issues like power quality or frequency problem or voltage problems, they should be solved. And because of the integration of this renewable energy, the existing protection system, because whenever solar is generating its own, we should have one type of protection system. When we have connected with the grid only, the protection should be different. Right now, what I am facing here is protection. So we should have two different levels of protection or adaptable protection. When solar is giving up its generation, it is coming in, there should be one type of protection, protection level one, let us say. When solar is not there, we are connected with the grid only, the protection level two should be in line. So the adaptable protection system is required. A lot of research is going on. Still, it is to be done. And the business opportunity for entrepreneurs, LVDC, grid management locally, operation and maintenance of distributed generation system, installation of rooftop SPVs. Of course, there are so many people now, so many firms are there doing the job, but most of them are unskilled, not trained in photovoltaics. Skilled people are required for installation of solar photovoltaics and their integrated connections in the house. And automated metering and communication is must. AMI and communication is must. And deregulation, of course, these topics most of you know. The world is a vertical generation, transmission, distribution, and the customer. And power is coming from top to bottom and money is flowing from bottom to top. Whereas the latest, we have independent system operators, generation, transmission, they are private. There are retail people who are purchasing from the generation and they are selling to us. There are customers. Customers are paying money. So this is the power deregulation. Of course, not done fully in any part of the India. Some Western countries like Germany, they are operating deregulated markets. Still, we have some problems. Not so easy in India. It will take time. And electricity trading through power exchange is introduced in many electricity markets. India also, we have one is India Energy Exchange, IEX, in 2008, and Power Exchange of India Limited, PXIL, we have. They are working under the guidance of Central Electricity Regulation. Regulation, again, there is a regulator. Then where is the question of deregulation? Central Electricity Authority, CEA, from Delhi is monitoring and controlling them. So it is not fully deregulated. It is required. And the Central Electricity Regulation Commission, it is there. With the entry of private operators in power sector, there is an increase in transparency and competition in the market. The key points of this power exchange includes facility for trading of electricity and more choice for the customers. Customers can have their own. But the challenge is power trading technology, market guarantee. Because like a vegetable, a farmer or somebody will bring vegetables in the market the morning hours to the market, there is no guarantee he have demand. supply demand, we do not know how it is moving. So market guarantee is to be ensured. Auctioning system, how to sell the power, fixed rate or based on the market availability and the gap between supply and demand, whether it is to be auctioned. And also theft of energy is a major thing which should be taken care of. So this is the challenge. And I am happy to inform the last week, October 12th, Nobel Prize announced in economics for the advances in auction theory. Auction theory for so many, but deregulated market definitely requires an auctioning system. So the Nobel Prize in economics for the year 2000 went to this auction starts from one area. There are different type of auctions. If you see, I have seen in my village, in my childhood, some people used to come with blankets in the evening hours, particularly in October, November. They will start from 10 rupees, 10, 15, 20. It goes up ascending order. It stops at somewhere. That will be the final price between seller and buyer. Whereas the other model, Dutch theory, the seller will start at higher level of, say, 100 rupees. It goes on down and finally somewhere it will be fixed. And as we know, Vickery theory, who has developed auction theory in power deregulation test book, if verify, you will get it, the Vickery theory. Like that, there are so many theories. And finally, these two great people got the Nobel Prize recently. It is announced on October 12th. These are the people who have got this at the age of 83 and 72, the lecturer and the student. Wilson and Milgram, I have read it last week in one of the magazine, and great salute to these people. And coming to the next, already we are in the midway, 1 hour is completed. Sir, any break is required for 5 minutes, or we can, shall I continue? Madam, shall I continue or any break is required?
It is your wish only, sir. If you want, you take for 5 minutes break or take one tea, after then return back to them.
Yes, sir. Yeah, all will take, because it is 1 hour generally your standard class. Yes, time. Yes. Break, sir. For 4 to 5 minutes, I will come back, sir.
Okay, sir. We'll start. Time is 10:55. We'll start for 11 o'clock.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sure. If having any video, it's having available any practical related video, you play the video.
Yeah. Of course, I do not have right now. Yeah.
Okay, okay, sure. No problem, sir. Dear participants, we'll have a short break. We'll start after 5 minutes later.
Yes, sir. I will start again. Continue. Shall I start, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay, madam. So now the next topic is transformer. The transformer which transfers energy from generators to the end user, working as a device for step up and step downs, like a faculty. The left side of the faculty, lot of textbooks, syllabus, curriculum, research theory, so many things are there at the left side, and in front of them are students or the upcoming power engineers or heroes of the coming century. So transformer has to take the input, has to deliver output with a little loss, transformation. So the latest developments in transformer theory are like this: higher losses in core. As on date, copper losses we are reducing, but still we have higher core loss, whether it is eddy current loss or hysteresis loss, which development iron loss, it is loss reduced by 60% to the existing CRGO steel, cold rolled grain oriented steel. If we say it is having 100 watt loss per 1 kg, the MRPs have only 40 watts loss per kg. High frequency operation like solid state transformers is picking up now, SST, and research is going on towards superconducting transformers. We have around one transformer of 63 kVA in one of the market in New Zealand, and a Sri Lanka transformer, it is a ABB in Switzerland, developed 150 kVA transformer. Superconducting transformers are there in the market, and in place of traditional mineral oil, a natural resource for cooling of the transformer, now people are using renewable oils or vegetable oils like coconut, soya bean and palm oil. They are good alternatives for transformer oil which are renewable. The limitations are inferior oxidative property, poorer low temperature profile, and higher viscosity and high cost to produce. These are the developments. The gaps here in the transformer technology: problems with the mineral oil of flammability. As on date, we are using oil is of mineral. The traditional brand name is transformer oil or grade B mineral oil. What we are using is for cooling as well as insulation. They are highly flammable. Beyond 140 degrees centigrade, they will catch fire. During short circuits in any transformer, fire accidents are common. So they have limitations. Sludge is getting formed in the existing transformer oil. Whenever transformer is breathing air in during its contraction and expansion due to loads, the oxygen is coming inside. Oxidization of oil, sludge is getting formed, which is blocking the cooling area. So sludge is getting formed is the gap. And exhaust of natural resource, mineral oils, non-biodegradable oils, environmentally unfriendly. Spilled oil is a toxic waste, and escaped oil into water such as rivers is harmful. Continuous monitoring of operating parameters is going on nowadays, particularly winding temperature, not oil temperature, oil level in the transformer, two key parameters in the transformer as on date. Continuously monitoring is required. What is the level in the transformer? What is the temperature? These two, it's a gap. We should not monitor continuously. AMT, MRPS metal transformers are only for distribution side due to the material cutting problem. They are very hard, requires a diamond cut. Even though there is a ease of control, solid state transformers as on mostly operating at higher frequencies of 100 Hz because of higher frequency, definitely hysteresis loss and eddy current loss, they are getting up. Also, solid state transformers mostly having electronic components requires air conditioning. So nowadays, FSTs are economical up to 3 MEA. Recently, I have attended one of the webinar given by Mr. Fanish Krishnamurthy from University of Houston on SST. He has given 2 webinars, 1 hour, 1 hour. There I have raised this question. Because once I have done this experiment on SST, I have raised a question. What about cooling and losses? Then he told, yes, there are restrictions up to 3 MEA. Right now, the technology available is for 3 MEA only. And in case of superconducting transformer, cooling is the issue. These are the gaps. And the opportunity, research, pricing and auctioning, P2P, sorry, it is coming from somewhere. Yeah, heavy weight, handling issues of the transformer. Transformer, you know, is a bulky device. Handling is a big issue and also occupying more space. I heard some of the countries, transformers are getting installed at higher elevations, so the space can be saved. And they are consuming mineral oil, a natural resource, and highly flammable. And in transformer design, to reduce the size, the flux density is going to be put at 1.7 Webers per meter square or around 1.8 Tesla, which is the almost the saturation value of CRGO steel. They are getting operated at 1.8 to reduce the size, but saturation, harmonics are there. Problems. The output power quality is getting affected with input disturbances like voltage swells and sags in transformers, and percolated power electronic device at load and pumping back harmonics to transformer. The transformer, which is connected to a distribution area, because of the power electronic devices, let's say in the form of a smart transformer, a smart motor or a PV system, the harmonics are getting pumped back into the system, which will affect the transformer definitely, which are very sensitive for harmonics. And also, testing of oil like dissolved gas analysis and pure analysis is required at regular intervals to ascertain the healthiness of liquid and solid insulations. And percentage impedance in design for reduced fault current, which leads to more voltage drop. In design side, the percentage impedance is being put at reduced value will give higher current but low voltage drop. If the percentage impedance is kept at higher side, the fault current is less but the voltage drop IZ is more. So there should be a compromise between fault current and the voltage drop. It is a gap. And parallel operation with the different groups and KVA ratings, it is to be taken care, because there are so many vector groups of DY1, DY11, YD1. They should be taken care. There is a gap definitely. And the opportunities, the limitations of even though we are using vegetable oils nowadays, I know Sri Lanka, Lankan transformers, having so many coconut trees, have developed a transformer of 63 kVA. Now they are using at distribution level, coconut oil filled distribution transformer. But they have problems of inferior oxidative properties, poorer low temperature property. At low temperature, the coconut oil is getting solidified. Of course, at low temperature, cooling is not required, so they are becoming solid. We know in our house also, the coconut bottle in the early hours of winter season, it is getting solidified and the viscosity is high. It should be low for the transformer cooling, but the coconut oil viscosity is high. It should be preferably less than 27 CSC, centistokes, but right now what we have is more than 40. It's a table, we can see what is how it is. And use in raw form, that is without any treatment, is restricted to LV scale transformers to be refined and purified to improve their properties. And mineral oil. Hence, coconut oil in point of insulation point of view is the best one. Moisture content, the mineral oil and say the coconut oil, they are good. And pore point, the fluidity is where it will stop, means becoming a liquid solidification. The pore point is minus 40 degrees centigrade, means up to minus 40 degrees centigrade, existing mineral oil is working satisfactorily. Whereas in case of coconut oil, at plus 23 itself, it is getting solidified. So there is a gap is existing, research can be done here. And palm oil getting solidified at 15 degree. Because these are the renewable oils which we can get regularly, this we should encourage now. flash point or fire point. Mineral oil is 140. The soybean oil is the number one and is the second with a 234. Palm oil is a 242. Coconut oil is a 225 degree centigrade. All these vegetable oils are far better than existing mineral oil in terms of the flash point. It is good for use. And the density for grams per cc, it is almost everything is less than one except palm oil. So where some research is to be done. And the viscosity of mineral oil is at 40 degree centigrade is a 9. The maximum is 27 permitted. Coconut oil is coming 29. Palm oil is 30. So from this table, we can say that confidently, we can say that these vegetable oils can be used for transformers. I hope some colleges, they are doing research. Any one of the participants or faculty member, whoever hearing me now, if anybody is interested, please entrust to some PG or UG student group to have experiment with a small transformer of 100 kVA or 50 kVA. Please take one transformer, two transformers, fill one transformer with mineral oil, fill which is costing around 60 rupees per liter. Take one more of coconut or palm oil or soybean available in market of around 100 to 150 rupees per kg. Fill it, load them for same time, monitor the parameters. That is the work what a student can do, PCR using. And finally, when the performance of coconut oil or palm oil is getting deteriorated, try to add some preservatives. That is the research, what we can do. If anyone participant is interested, the faculty member, anybody is interested, please do this. If required, take my help. Once it is done to measure the performance in terms of moisture content, oxidation, sludge formation, breakdown strength, moisture content, I will definitely help to test them in my plant or known testing laboratories. We can do, we can evaluate. I will definitely help in this area. Smart transformer. In the figure, it is here. At the top, the conservator, oil level can be monitored, the ambient temperature can be monitored with the proper sensor. And here, onload tap changer number 5. Onload tap changer. Here, we can operate the tap changer remotely in a smart way. And at the bottom, core and coil protection. Here, the temperature can be seen with the help of sensors. And here, the bottom number 3 is a thermal protection. We can monitor the temperature of oil as well as windings. Number 2, overload protection. All these sensors can be connected remotely with the help of a communication network or maybe a cloud, IoT or IIoT. Now the latest term is IOMT. You may be knowing Internet of Mobile Things. Internet of Mobile Things, IOMT. So have a drone in particular area, assign the transformers with particular numbers. Let them move freely here and there, the drones, monitor the performance of transformer and give feedback. Let us say the oil temperature of this particular transformer is high, it can give the correct reaction. If some filling is required, Internet of Mobile Technology can have a drone with oil at the top. The oil can be filled directly with a valve. So that is smart transformer. They can monitor the transformers online. Protecting the power system from the load disturbances by isolating the source, providing unity power factor. Definitely, the smart technology will operate the transformers at unity level, unity power factor. It reduces the grid loss. It protects the loads from power supply disturbances. It eliminates the tap changer requirement. Even the taps can be removed. It will adjust the incoming voltage itself so that the tapping is not required. And also, it provides a backup and reduces the outage length. It provides reactive power system harmonic filtering. The transformer itself will have a reactive power compensation device which can be taken care internally. And also in substations, it can be used to feed control equipment or to feed the DC microgrid. That's why, in this way, the smart transformers will help. And the business opportunity, sensors are required for transformers. So person whoever is interested, and algorithms for power evacuation or optimum power flow, it can be done. IIoT and artificial intelligence can be used in transformer maintenance. And also, as explained, IOMT, like drones for maintenance works, can be done. This is a transformer, smart transformer. And solid state transformers, lot of research is going on. There are so many varieties of two stage, three stage solid state transformers. The right side, there is a figure. Take HVDC, convert into HVDC. Once it is converted into HVDC, again go back to inverter of HVDC to HVAC at high frequency. High frequency AC supply. Once it is high frequency, give it to a transformer. Because of the high frequencies in the transformer, the size of transformer can be reduced, and we have so many advantages. Again, step down to low voltage of high frequency only. Here, the high frequency AC can be brought down to low frequency AC, not required. It is high frequency AC. It can be converted into low voltage DC. And again, LVAC can go to DC to AC, it can go. So HVAC, HVDC, high voltage to low voltage, step down. High frequency AC and low voltage DC. Here the advantage, finally the customer is getting, like earlier he is getting low voltage AC only, but it has seen the transmission has gone through high voltage AC and higher frequencies. And wherever we have renewable energy like solar power, the LVDC can be connected here. The LVDC can be connected here. So it can be used directly. That is the LVDC technique. And the storage batteries, wherever they are there, the storage batteries also can be connected. They can be charged or they can be taken back whenever required. So this is three-stage solid-state transformer. And it replaces the traditional power transformer. And the one more advantage of this transformer is the volume and weight of these transformers will be reduced. It allows high utilization of magnetic core and they have low physical profile. With the help of this solid state transformers, the generations of different frequencies, intercontinental, say India and other country of frequency having 60 hertz or 25 hertz, can be connected together with the help of solid state transformer. Otherwise, the prime condition of parallel operation, frequencies should be same, will not permit. Here, with the help of SST, they can be clubbed. They can be merged or parallel with the help of this SST technology. So the SST is helping to parallel two systems of different frequencies. That is one more advantage. So it can be done. However, there are gaps. Presence of power electronic converter and harmonics. And capacity as on it is 3 MVA because higher frequency leads to, even though the weight is coming down, the harmonics and iron losses will go up. This is one of the experiments which is done in our plant by us long back. We have taken one supply. We have operated one small transformer of 200 VA, yet 100 or 102 hertz, they are given to one light and one small motor. We have operated these two. This is SST technique, what we have done. And we have observed the transformer operated satisfactorily at 102 hertz frequency, and the light output of incandescent lamp is higher than the normal 50 hertz. Because of the higher frequency, the lux level of these lamps are higher, and the motor, because of high frequency, it was running at higher speeds. So the motor size can be reduced at the higher frequencies. So this we have done practically for 1 hour, and we have tabulated all the results. They are satisfactory. Of course, there are gaps, harmonic superconducting. they are under experimental stage with the presence of superconducting transformers with the better technology of core material. The copper loss can be brought down to zero and the iron loss can be kept at the lowest level. So the transformer right now, we have the transformers of 98% we have with conventional technology. With MRPAS, it is going to 98.5. With the superconducting technology, definitely the transformer efficiency will be going up and may touch 99.6. It is expected. But problems are there. So a New Zealand firm has developed a 1000 kVA high superconducting transformer whose efficiency was 99.86 at 3.3 kV level and down to 220 volt. The right side figure is a transformer. Everything is available here. A cryogenic cooling system is required to maintain at 0 degree centigrade, mostly with the liquid nitrogen. Not so simple job. And this is a transformer with the liquid nitrogen at 1 bar. This is the green color diagram. And this is the technology used here. The gaps are cooling because maintaining lowest temperature, not so easy job. It requires a lot of technology to be adapted. So there is opportunity for research. If we are able to provide a better cooling, seen yesterday or before yesterday in one magazine, the superconductors, they were developed, somebody has developed working at room temperature of 27 degree centigrade. If that is materialized, well and fine, everything will be good. So here, one is the technology, the other one is cooling, and the main thing is operation of superconducting transformer during fault conditions. And if we go back to our machine design system, design of electrical machines, in general, selecting the copper conductor, what the thumb rule is, one square mm copper is going to bear, is permitting 4 amps of current. 1 square mm for 4 amps is the as on date technology what we are using for machine design in transformer or generator or motor. With the superconductor, 1 square mm carries roughly 30 amperes, 30 to 32 amps, means 7 to 8 times higher side. So for the same power capacity, the transformer size, the copper conductor size has come down by 8 times. 1 square mm is going to carry 30 amps with superconducting techniques, cryogenic cooling. But say a fault has occurred in the transformer, the fault current definitely, which is 10 to 25 times. Fault current is nothing but the rated current by percentage impedance, which is 4 to 10% or 15% maximum. So definitely the fault current, let us say 10 times. So now the conductor of 1 square mm is carrying a 300 amps and suddenly the cooling failed because the fault current is being carried till the relay protection relay operates and trips the circuit breaker. Meanwhile, if cooling also fails, fault occurred, cooling system failed, then it will be a great disaster to the transformer. So definitely some research is to be done. If a fault is coming, some alternate cooling arrangement should come back immediately into the system to cool down. Otherwise, we'll go end up with nothing. Gas also will not be there. So that is a gap here existing. Research is to be done here. And coming to the next item, it is of the dark horse of industry, induction motor which converts electrical energy into mechanical energy and driving the pumps, compressors, fans, whatnot, everything. A motor is the dark horse in the system. A good and faithful servant is induction motor, particularly squirrel cage induction motor in the system. Of course, there is a lot of theory in being taught in colleges regarding squirrel cage, clip ring or synchronous motors. Just I will touch what is the latest trend. Now we have smart motors. in the smart era, smart devices era, we have smart motors, IoT based sensors attached to the body or frame of motor, which are monitoring the performance wirelessly and conveying the status to control room or smartphones. This technique is simple, and a sensor can be installed to the motor and data can be stored in the cloud with the suitable communication protocol, and the information can be given to the maintainer or to the manufacturer. From there, the suitable remedial action can be given. And all test pro device, a handheld device now available in market for monitoring purpose, which is useful to know the imbalance in voltage and current. We know the unbalance between phase and phase is not permitted. So right now we have motors which will operate satisfactorily if the unbalance between phase and phase is less than 3%. More than that leads to higher currents and the temperature will be 6 times the normal. If the unbalance is a 3%, the temperature rises 18 times. It will be like that. So differently, 3%, 18%. So, is there any unbalance in voltage and current? The unbalance may be due to the supply problem, or maybe the winding, internal short circuits in one of the winding. It may lead to unbalanced current. And the other technique is MCSA. Motor current signature analysis to know the condition and predict the failures in core and windings. And company Areva has a technique, MPATH, electrical motor performance analysis and trending hardware. It measures and analyzes the motor voltage and current to check particularly the rotor bars deterioration, eccentricity, or the missing balance in the rotor and bearing and the bearing condition. It will monitor. And we have energy efficient motors. Early days we have motors, now we have energy efficient motors having the labels of IE1, IE2, IE3. Improved efficiency 1, 2, 3 as per IEC category or NEMA, National Electrical Manufacturer Association, USA. We have categories IE1, IE2, IE3. Standard motor, high efficient. Premium efficient is IE4 now. Right now, early days, we have induction motor efficiency. We have seen up to 80% or 85%. Now, with the latest techniques of improved design, improved material of iron and copper, now we are seeing the motor efficiency is touching 97%. Almost at par with a transformer. A static device transformer is giving 98%. A rotating device induction motor is giving already now 97. Plant we have valves. We can reduce the speed of induction motor by giving variable voltage and frequency. Hence, the horsepower, which is proportional to cubic times of speed, can be done, and we can save a lot of energy. So VFDs are extensively being used nowadays in industries. So this is VFD. As you know, most of you know, VFD, the incoming AC, rectified to DC, again back to AC, fixed AC supply converted to DC, and a variable voltage and frequency. Actually, it is not a VFD, it is a VVFD. So VVFD, variable voltage and variable frequency drives are there. By changing these two, because again we cannot change only frequency, we have to change voltage also. V by F should be maintained constant to have constant flux. So variable voltage and variable frequency drives are available in the market. They are being used now, but the challenges are harmonics. Because of power converter devices, wherever there is a PED, definitely there is a harmonic polluting the electrical sine wave. Pure sine wave, it is polluting. Hence, here harmonics are getting created. You can see in the VFT diagram, a pure sine wave, finally the pulses are coming. So pulse train is coming. So it is a variable frequency, variable voltage. Harmonics are coming. Huge capital required and space and cooling. If we see this waveform, instead of a pure sine wave like this, we are getting a polluted sine wave like this. That's why challenge only harmonics leads to higher voltage drops and more heat. And what is the gap? Sir, any problem in PPT sharing? Anything is getting overlapped?
No, sir.
Okay. Yeah.
Hello.
No, sir.
So
no, sir.
Now the
sir, no,
gap.
No, no, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Gap and
research scope. Research scope. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So now gaps and scope for research improve the efficiency beyond 97. Like transformer, it should go to 97, 99. How it is possible? Use motors also. Which we are doing by injecting fresh grease once in 6 months. It should be lifetime lubricated. Complete use of IIoT for maintenance purpose. Harmonic-less drives are required. Opportunities to use artificial intelligence in predictive maintenance and use of robotics in maintenance. And the business opportunities, condition monitoring of motors, vibration analysis and thermography. Now, I am seeing so many people are coming to us because we have motors of more than 900 in our plant, ranging from 0.37 kilowatt to 3 megawatt. We have 600 numbers of motors. And whenever we are calling external parties to do condition monitoring, vibration analysis and thermography, number of players in market are less. Again, initially I have told, there are people with equipment, but they are not technically competent. If technically competent, lack of practical knowledge. So combination of these two, tough job. Definitely we require people, industries requires people having theoretical background and knowledge as well as equipment and the judging power from the vibration analysis and from the thermography. They should be able to tell where is the problem and what to do. Even they should be ready to attend and rectify the problem. And energy audit of motors and incorporation of VFD. In an industry, energy auditors are less. Bureau of Energy Efficiency, authorizing people as energy managers or as energy auditors. There are less people in the market nowadays. Energy auditors are required. Opportunity is existing. Incorporation of VFDs. Wherever there is an industry, have an energy audit. Inform them where is the scope for incorporation of VFDs for energy saving. But should confidently able to convince the consumer that you invest 100 rupees, the power will be saved, it will come back in the form of payback in this much of time. Any payback less than 3 years. For example, in my plant where I am working, in 2015, we have taken decision to incorporate VFDs. So far, we have installed 80 number of variable frequency drives for our pumping system. Right from volt up to 6. Megawatt. And the payback, we got back entire money within 9 months. 9 months, we got the total investment of 12 crores. And last 5-6 years, we are enjoying the benefits of those VFDs. Of course, there are some problems with the harmonics and some cables got failed, but the benefits what we are getting back around 15 crores per year, these failures are less. And so retrofit the existing motor with energy efficient motor. One option is go for VFD. if the VFD, the motor is not designed for those VFDs because the sine wave is not pure, go for energy efficient motor. Audit industry, find out the efficiency, find out the suitable energy efficient motor available, convince the customer, I will replace this motor with a new, or you go and replace this motor with energy efficient motor, your savings are like this and your payback is like this. So there is opportunity existing, but the person should be technically competent. He should be able to convince the customer with his techniques. And the next one is switchgear protection and measurements. Toughest subject in electrical engineering, electrical power systems. The latest trend is use of vacuum circuit breakers for EHV. We know we have either MOCB or SF6 circuit breakers in EHV up to 765 kV. We have in our plant 220 kV, we have SF6 circuit breaker. Now, vacuum circuit breakers are available in market, which are mostly maintenance free. Right now, the technology is available up to 33 kV. If I want to use for 220 kV, I have to put some 5 or 6 in series. That is the trend what is going on. Or we are using SF6, sulfur hexafluoride, fluorines. The released one is danger to the environment. Again, it may pollute and also harmful to the human. So we should use vacuum circuit breakers only for higher voltages. Use of numerical relays. The generation one of electromagnetic relays replaced with generation number two of static relays, transistors, then replaced with generation three. Now we have numerical relays having so many advantages. They are being used now. And now we have AMI smart meters and NB-IoT. So the smart meters are the part of overall advanced metering infra, AMI solution that measure and record consumers' electricity usage at different times of day and send this information to the energy supplier through over the air communication technology, maybe IoT or clouds or whatever it may be. And most of you might have seen the local newspapers 4 or 5 days back. There is a technique, NB-IoT, narrow band Internet of Things, is a low power wide area network technology that connects different types of new IoT devices and services. It helps in improving the power consumption, building system capacity and spectrum efficiency. Last 1 month, we are hearing the central government, the government of India has told all the state governments install digital power meters in the agricultural sector to know what is the consumption. There are some oppositions, of course it is a different story. So now they are saying, now the immediate requirement is 25 crore smart energy meters. This news of NB-IoT, this is by one of the big industrialists in India. He want to capture this market. This news has come. Of course, I have removed the company name here. The gaps are VCB is available up to 33 kV only. We have to find out higher sizes, lack of established technology for EHV, TCCB. We don't have DC circuit breakers. Closing and opening times of existing circuit breakers are around 100 milliseconds, which should be real. And we have to find. Relay coordination to distributed generation. Because of PVs and wind turbine, the existing relay system or protection system coordination is getting defeated. So there is a gap. And what is the opportunity existing? VCB for above 33 kV rating. The existing vacuum bottle of 33 kV rating with a gap of 8 to 10 mm should be enhanced so that the VCB will be ready for 220 kV or 765 kV or in future of 1200 kV. It should be. And we should require higher voltage circuit breakers in DC or EHV and also use of artificial intelligence for relay coordination. This is must for AI. Adaptive protection, adaptive relaying is required, particularly where their DC is incorporated. Wavelets in relaying, particularly differential protection area, the wavelet technology is being used now. Still, some research is required. And business, I know, I am having 1200 numbers of relays, IDMT, then static and numerical. We have both, all three varieties, something we have already replaced. So the business opportunity, existing, let us take IDMT. inverse the definite minimum time of electromechanical relay, fixed steps of settings of 1, 1.25 or 1.5 or 1.4, the numerical relays continuously we can vary, like a ceiling fan in our house of old regulator of 1, 2, 3, 4 fan regulator, now it can be adjusted continuously without any steps. So we should able to, the business is existing to retrofit the existing electromechanical relays with the numerical relays. We have to convince the customer and we have to use these new relays. Also, relay coordination study. Whenever we are expanding business, we are diversifying, we are adding distributed generation, definitely the existing relay coordination should be adjusted accordingly. A lot of business is existing everywhere, but the people available in the market, very less. 3 years back, when we have floated a tender for relay coordination after incorporating 12 megawatt solar power plant in the existing loads of 36 megawatt, we want to know the relay coordination. We have floated a tender. We have received only 2 offers in national tender. 2 offers, one is from GE and the other one is from other local Hyderabad party. Finally, they have done it. Number of players in relay coordination study are very less because the complex calculations. Of course, now we have softwares like ETAP and DigiSilent, which can be done very easily. And also testing of meters and relays. These are to be tested and calibrated at regular intervals as per the standards or National Electric Code or IEC or IEEE. They are to be tested once in 2 years or sometimes 1 year. If it is digital relay or numerical relay, once in 5 years to be tested. Market testing of meters, testing of relays, doing relay coordination study, we require people. And the next one is the hot topic of the day, the burning topic, electrical vehicles and microgrids. We have to store the electrical energy. Storage batteries for electrical vehicles and microgrids.
Manchi problem artham chesukoru.
So, madam, any problem? So, the present batteries in the market, we have so many varieties. Madam, any problem?
DL participants, please mute yourself, please.
Sir, Koti Reddy, sir, unmute your audio, sir. Koti Reddy, sir. Hello, sir, Koti Reddy, sir, unmute your audio. Your audio is muted. Hello.
Everybody.
Yes, sir.
Is it okay now?
Yes, it's okay, sir.
Slide is also okay?
Yes, sir, it's okay, sir.
Yeah. Now the storage batteries, burning topic, as on date is electrical vehicle or microgrid. So now we have so many technologies, the traditional lead acid battery, then nickel cadmium, nickel metal hydroxide, lithium ion. We have so many varieties. Again, in lithium ion, there are so many techniques, lithium metal, air, we have density in terms of whatever energy it stores and gives per kg of their weight. As on date, the lowest is the traditional battery of lead acid of 30, nickel cadmium is giving 45 to 80, lithium ion as on date is around 150 or 160. Of course, this PPT totally it will be shared, these tables can be used and they can be updated as and when things are getting changed. This is the table I have taken last week from one of the website, Battery University. It is getting changed or updated regularly. And the cycle life, one cycle is nothing but one charge and fully discharge. The cycle life point of view, lead acid is having only 200 to 300, lithium ion is touching 1000. And fast charging time, nickel cadmium is the number one. Because of its higher temperature and capacity, it can be charged back fully within 1 hour, whereas lead acid takes more time of around 10 hours. The self-discharge point of view, lead acid is the number one. The worst one is again nickel cadmium only. Cell voltage, we have 1.2 for nickel cadmium family and 2 volt for lead acid and lithium ion 3.6 or 3.8 volt. And also the load current best result is coming at 1C, C, 0.5C, 0.2C or 1C. C, the capacity factor. If it is 1C, of course, most of you may be knowing already, let us take a 100 ampere hour battery. If the current, the load current is 100, if it is discharging in 1 hour, 1 hour, 100 ampere, 100 ampere hour, it is 1 hour or 1C. If the fellow is getting used at reduced load of 50 amps, it works for 2 hours, then it will be 0.5C, means the capacity is reduced. If it is a fast, it can be 2C or 5C. So means we are discharging at faster rate, the life will come down. And operating temperature, they will work satisfactorily up to 60 degree centigrade. Maintenance point of view, lead acid battery requires more maintenance, regular topping up required. Nickel cadmium 2 to 3 months, lithium ion nothing is required. So this is the table which is giving important points of the battery technology available as on date in market. So this is to be updated regularly. Generally my habit is I used to put a table in my diary. Whenever things are getting changed from newspaper or journals, I will adjust or I will upgrade them. And the challenges, the technology, there are so many technologies of lead acid, the nickel cadmium, lithium ion. So we should rings and in case kilometer, there is a range anxiety, and the battery operated vehicles, the cost is higher side. Environmental effects, of course, everybody says electrical vehicle is a green vehicle, green energy. But definitely the power, whatever required for the electrical vehicle being produced at some area, there it is getting affected. And in case of fuel cell, when it is moving on the roads, definitely the byproduct is the water and the temperature, they are polluting. So we cannot say electrical vehicle is 100% environmental friendly as on date. And the toxicity, whether it is lithium ion or lead acid, the things that whatever coming out, the fumes or other things coming out from those batteries during their charge or discharge, they are toxic in nature, which will affect the safety of human and the security of human and equipment. And the powertrain design, it should be compact for electrical vehicles. And the problem as on date, whenever we are using a battery for vehicle or in my substations, we do not know the state of charge. We do not know. A battery is charged 1 hour back, it is running. But right now, if I want to know what is the charge or the status of charge, I do not know. So that is the challenge. So means there is a lifetime uncertainty. When it is going to discharge fully or when the life is exhausted, it is not known. Requirement of suitable charger and charging current. There also, whether the battery is being used for 0.5C or 1C or 5C, it is not known. So the charging current and the charger size cannot be fixed. That is the challenge. So scope is, right now we have lithium ion batteries up to 200 kilometer with a particular size, which is reasonable for a vehicle. We are getting up to 200 or 300. It should go beyond 200 or 300. Even it may be required to go up to 500 kilometer range batteries at reasonable weight. The weight cannot be too much because the dead weight of vehicle cannot be too much. It will itself will consume more energy. And the integration of powertrain components. So many components of DC to DC, DC to AC and controllers, they should be integrated properly. Autonomous charging in future, autonomous driving, and the scope is there for battery swapping. Like a LPG cylinder, have battery shops with standard battery sizes. Let the vehicle comes with a discharged battery, take out the battery, put a new battery, send it out like a petrol fill. Battery swapping, transfer, how is the batteries, what shall be the technology, the pricing mechanism, like auction theory, definitely there should be something research is to be done to find out a genuine technique or methodology how the swapping is to be done. Wireless charging, as on date, the efficiency is around 70 to 80%. The batteries should be charged with the wireless charging of efficiency beyond 90%. Lot of research is going on. Still something is required in wireless charging area. Super fast charging. Right now, as shown in the previous slide, the batteries, they are getting charged in 1 hour to 10 hours. In case of lead acid, 10 hours. In case of nickel cadmium, it can be 1 hour. But who will wait for 1 hour? Like a LPG cylinder, it should be, or a petrol pump, the maximum waiting time is around 5 minutes. We should be able to charge the batteries within 5 minutes, then only the consumer will be attracted. This is possible with the help of high voltage DC. Say a 500 volt DC charger can charge the battery within 10 minutes to 80%. So there is a scope to find out super fast chargers, wireless chargers, peer-to-peer, P2P charging, means with the help of other vehicle through wireless, or a drone charging. New charging technologies are required, that is smart charging or vehicle to grid. And finally, scope is existing to pump back the stored energy in the vehicle of the battery to the grid, V2G, also a P2P, peer to peer. So as on date, the expectations of lithium air battery energy density in near future will be as follows. It's a dream only. Lithium air, right now lithium batteries are having up to 200 watt hour per kg. Lithium air batteries having a lot of scope to go up to 1000 watt hour per kg. Then only the, even here in this case, the solar power can be stored easily. Lithium sulfur, lithium ion. Of course, right now the lithium is 200 from bottom to top. Lithium future may be 250 300 short term. Lithium ion, finally lithium air shall be there for 1000 watt hour per kg. Business opportunities, battery charging stations with renewable energy like solar, photovoltaic and wind. We can have battery charging stations. Now they're coming up. Government is giving licenses. Battery charging stations with hybrid storage system is the opportunity for business. Battery swapping shops, battery shops to take the discharged battery to fix the back the fully charged battery. Battery swapping shop can be installed, but right now in urban cities, vehicle to grid or peer to peer service, electrical vehicles and battery on rent. Right now, the Energy Efficiency Corporation of India is giving vehicles to the government departments on rent basis. Hourly, they are charging around 40,000 with a driver of 3,000 kilometers per month. Like that, they have some firm policies. Electrical vehicles and batteries can be given on rent to the users. Mobile app for EV needs, like Swiggy, Zomato, or other marts, there should be app for electrical vehicle needs. I do not know whether it is existing or not. There should be a app. It should be integrated with all the facilities in the city so that the consumers will install the app and they will go for their requirements. And a business, wherever new business, definitely. Toxic batteries should be disposed properly. Then finally, one option is disposal, collect the waste material. The other one is recycling. So recycling of non-biodegradable materials is a business opportunity. And lastly, the safety and energy audit. As we know, 25% of all fires are due to electricity as per NFPA. And electricity is causing approximately 5% of fatal accidents. 8% of deaths occurs in India. Factories are due to electricity as per labor regulation, labor commissioner. Electrical hazards are often present in all work areas. So it is essential that non-electrical groups like a welder or a plumber, whoever use electricity, whether domestic, from mobile phone to microwave or commercial or industrial, they should use them carefully. non-electrical workers like welder, crane operator, excavator, cement worker, painters must understand the criticality and receive electrical training that is specific to their job. So now I am taking up this arc flash safety because nowadays it is gaining momentum. Arc flash study is must nowadays. Most of the rules or factories are implementing this. Now NFPA 70E, National Fire Protection Association of USA says arc flash study is a must. So if you see the person, he's having a PPE, like our Corona kit, Corona PPE is having everything top to bottom. So if we take a live conductor here, early days we used to think about electric shock. Now not only shock, fire accidents, because electric flash, arc is nothing but flow of electricity in the air without any conducting media. Air itself will conduct electricity in the form of arc. So if it is a live, early days we used to think only electric shock, now arc. Because the arc energy can be 35,000 degree Fahrenheit, which will hit a person or nearby equipment at a load of 220 kg. So we have to do for each and every electrical power point or board or switch gear restricted space where a person should not go, a limited approach boundary where a qualified person can go and do, and finally arc flash means there is a safe distance to be maintained. So whenever there is a electrical switchboard, if we touch or if arc occurs, we have to calculate what is the arc energy in calories per cm square. Based on that, fix the boundaries and definitely should have some arc flash shoot like this. A hood or a helmet, a fan shut with shoe and hand gloves is a must to avoid accidents. So arc flash study demand is going up now, and I'm sure there are very small, less people in the country, in particularly in India, to do this job. So opportunities are existing here to do this job. So electrical safety audit, which is very must, whether it is a house, industry, educational institutes, college or university, or a factory or a commercial establishment, electrical safety audit is a must. People are doing audits for accounts, people are doing audits for energy, but forgetting safety, which is very, very important, because electrical accident, the person can. Audit recommendations. Of course, a lengthy paragraph which can be read in PPT, which I am going to share today itself. So here, just I want to say one point. I know almost all the engineering colleges have workshops, laboratories where we are using a 220 volt AC, maybe high voltage engineering, wherever there is a subject in PG or UG, HV laboratory, so many machines of AC and DC you are using. I am sure safety audit, electrical safety audit of workshops not being taken place, where the students are going to do experiments, different groups, different people, with anxiety they are doing experiments. I am sure safety audit in terms of electricity, electrical accidents or arc flash not taking place in most of the educational institutes where students are working. That's why I am requesting all of you, all the faculty members, whoever hearing me now, have a electrical safety audit at least in one machine laboratory, or maybe simulation system laboratory, maybe different computer laboratory, but definitely shall have electrical safety audit. One faculty member with some 3-4 students can form a group, or it can be a small mini project, a project for students of PG or UG. Please do the safety audit, find out unsafe things, a loose connection, insulation failure, or bare wires are used without plug top, or not using earth connection. Please audit, suggest the measures, see that things are set right, otherwise may see some accidents unnecessarily. If required, I will help, I will extend my help. I will come forward voluntarily to train one or two students beginning days so that they can do happily. They can settle there also with a business. I will definitely come voluntarily to any of the college or checklist if required. I will forward. Please check up my email ID and ask me. I will send the checklist shooting to your educational institutes. Safety audit can be done safely to avoid accidents in coming days. And these are the things what I have taken some photographs. Excavators do not know there may be underground cable. They may met with accident. The painters doing paint on this tower can fall down or going top by accident. If the supply is switched on, they may met with accident. This is a McDonald's restaurant which went under electrical fire. A fruit center having a mixer or grinder or something having electricity, and nearby a vehicle is parked, petrol, the flammable liquid is parked. If something goes wrong, major accident. The data centers having electricity of 415 volt or 230 volt, there is a chance. A welder doing welding like this can have a chance of electrical accident, and crane operators can hit the overhead lines. And the doctors in hospitals, ICU rooms, all the equipment working on electrical supply definitely requires a safety audit. And wrong use, keeping one spike guard in series other, because the points are less at the end of the switchboard, keeping them in series, overloading them, or using metal objects when a fuse fails, or wet areas, covers are open, or keychain or jewelry things are getting hanged to the switchboards. And this is a thing what I want to finish in another 5 to 10 minutes. This is the multimeters where we are using for the last 30 years in our factory. Most of the engineering colleges, electrical and electronic appliances repair shop, we are using such type of multimeter having 3 pins, one common, one is for voltage and one is for current, and costing 5,000 rupees. One of our engineers in Hyderabad NFC nuclear fuel complex, electronic engineer with this meter, met with the accident and died on the spot. Meter is like this. Common point is existing, the black one. The red fellow, she has kept in this hole of the left side ampere, means current measurement. The probes will be in series with the system, and the criteria here by accident, it should be kept, the selection should be kept in amperage range. Now, if the selection is in ampere and selection is in ampere mode, if the leads are kept in common and voltage mode, this meter will see very, very high voltage, and the result is definitely fire, a flashover. So what I'm requesting is, now we have a high-end multimeters costing 15,000, having a safety latch or left side amperage. Whenever we are keeping selection in voltage, the voltage probe hole only get open. The lead can be kept here only. So it is having a safety feature. If we keep in voltage mode, current cannot be measured. If it is kept in current mode, we can measure only current but not voltage. This meters, please see that in our laboratories. If you don't have, please use this high hand safe multimeters. Opportunities in this area: safety system, energy conservation measures, arc flash energy estimates, business, safety audit, arc flash study, and safety and standards and codes. We have so many standards: International Electrotechnical Commission, Bureau of Indian Standard, IEEE, NEMA. If you see this, IEC is a private, Bureau of Indian Standard is Government of India's, IEEE is a private, NEMA is a National Electrical Manufacturer Association. A private body is framing standards and codes for the use in country. And why we are not doing? There is an opportunity. Why we can't have standards by private professional bodies in India like Institution of Engineers, ISTE, or other agencies? Definitely we should have standard bodies, why government only has to do everything? BIS, Bureau of Indian Standard, like NEMA in India also, either Institution of Engineers, IST or some other body, shall have committees, frame the rules and regulations, give to the industries and consumers. And the next one is COSIPS. This I have taken, this is my own. Computer Aided Study in Power Systems. Computer Aided Study in Power Systems. Electrical engineers requires various tools for jobs to make their job easy. There are few software programs for whether it is relay coordination, arc flash or anything. There are softwares available. Power system analysis is to be done regularly whenever we are integrating with the whenever we are going for DC, microgrid, smart grid, electrical vehicle facts and drives, power allocation, harmonics or reactive power mitigation, or newly designed power system, business expansion, mall operation or protective relays, improvements, every area we require calculations which are possible nowadays with the help of softwares. So we can have, presently we have PVSYST for solar design, MATLAB Simulink, everybody knows, SK Power Tool, Easy Power, My Power, DG Silent Power Factory, ETAP available for power system analysis, Homer Energy for optimum power allocation, Dialex for lighting design. We have so many things. These can be used. Of course, these are the slides. ETAP is the number one in this. By opening the tab, these are the things what are available in a ETAP. SLD preparation, load flow, short circuit, relay coordination, sizing of transformer, arc flash. This ETAP software is having everything including microgrid and renewable source. Open the tab as much we want, we will get completely. This recently I have given a 3-hour training to VIT and other universities. If anybody is interested, please contact me. We can have one webinar on this for 2 to 3 hours. Because this ETAP software is costing around 15 lakhs. Some of the colleges already having 15 lakhs. The training is costing around 5 lakhs. But the minimum things for students, I can tell through a webinar of 2 to 3 hours. So the ETAP can do calculations, can be visualized the relay coordination, how the relays are going to operate. Homer Pro, most of you know. And finally, the last one is human resource. In the present era of Industrial Revolution 4, where digital technology is going on, artificial intelligence is existing, we should train and retain the people, training from college level to the industry, update the knowledge, develop the soft skills, it is must. As you know, most of you are already seeing the curriculum is vastly outdated and very slow to react fast changing industry needs. So it should be dynamic. Students need to be trained not only on their subject, but also in terms of soft skills and life skills, like critical thinking, problem solving, and communication proficiency. So most of the educations are producing, as you know, graduates, but the skilled people are required. So I am proposing, definitely there should be on-job training of 3 months before entering final year. Miscellaneous retrofits can be done to remove the old electromagnetic relays with the numerical relays, and renovations can be done wherever required. And as example, building. Here we have green. It should generate its own power supply for entire thing, net zero building. It is there in Delhi. Indira Paryavaran Bhavan, which is constructed in 2014. It is there in Delhi. Smart appliances, you know, smart fan, smart thermostat, with the help of Wi-Fi and IoT, they are working. The streetlight system, the control system should be through Wi-Fi, very automatic. And the lastly, the conclusions, I'm not putting any paragraph here. The theme of this today's program, green energy and sustainable growth. So I am taking go for green energy, but it shall be SD-RAM. SD-RAM I have taken for since because nowadays people are talking computer side terminology only. So I have taken SD-RAM. Anything, any development, any work should be sustainable, simple. It is kept, gaps are kept each box. Please fill yourself later on after getting this PPT, you can put N number. It should be simple, sustainable, smart, and it should be durable in the life we should be able to depend. And it should be reliable and reasonable, realistic. and cost should be affordable, and we should be able to achieve it. Putting simply on paper, no, it should be done practically, achievable, and finally, it should be able to maintainable. Whenever there is equipment, we should be able to maintain. If you take smartphones early days, we can replace the battery. Nowadays, Motorola E3, E4 Plus, we cannot replace the battery, so we have to change the phone. But no, it should be maintained or modular. The battery is having problem, replace only battery. In a motor, only bearing problem, replace the bearing. Modular. So this is the thing what I have told for the last 2 hours. Thanks to all. Thanks to the organizers. Thanks to the management of BVRIT. Thanks to the faculty member. And big thanks to all the participants who are hearing me patiently for the last 2 hours. I hope my this 2 hour talk on this definitely has given you some inputs to know what is going on industry, what the challenges we are facing, what we are expecting in the form of research. And also I have put something where the opportunities existing for business. The thing what I have done totally for the last 2 hours, no inventions, no research, no calculations. I have taken real practical things, what is going on from my observations with my updating knowledge up to microgrids and electrical vehicle. I have put forth everything here. Everything I have brought light from generator up to the latest microgrid. Everything I have kept here. Conservation, equipment, human resource, safety, everything I brought here. I hope this speech will definitely help you in future in developing academic programs, curriculum, or training the students. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Anybody having any doubt, please ask me. If possible, I will answer. If time is not there, you can mail me also. I will reply through mail within a day, and entire PPT will be shared to all by evening. Thank you. Thank you again to all. Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir, for your great session. And we learned a lot, seriously. And we are grateful for the time and the effort you took to share your thoughts and experiences with us. Your enthusiasm is contagious, seriously. And we hope to participate in more of your presentations. Thank you once again, sir, for your contribution.
Thank you, ma'am. Yeah.
Dear participants, those who are having any doubts, or any queries, please directly interact with our resource person.
Because I may not able to open chat box and see. Please enable their mic. They can talk. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Those who are having any queries, just to directly interact with our resource person, unmute your audio and ask the questions or any queries. He will ready to interact with you. Thank you, sir. Goti Reddy sir, it's a very nice lecture, and also it's an excellent lecture, and a lot of practical things you have discussed. I think I hope all the participants to enjoyed your sessions. Thank you once again on behalf of our college as well as the management. It's open your plant, sir. It's no problem.
Yeah. Whoever is interested can see for some time. August also I have shown. Since questions are not coming, okay. So welcome to this heavy water plant. Heavy water being used as a moderator or a coolant for nuclear power plants, nuclear reactors. We have a plant in Manuguru near Bhadrachalam to produce 200 tons of heavy water per annum. We have two divisions, CPP captive power plant, where we have 30 megawatt of three numbers coal-based boilers. 15 kilometer away we have Singareni collieries. We are getting coal, and 2 kilometer away we have river Godavari, from where we are getting water. Raw water is taken, purified, 99.5% deuterium oxide content. We are getting heavy water, and we have production plant. So this is started in 1991. Yeah, for 500 acres land, employees are 2000. Total power requirement those days was 50 megawatt. Now we are consuming around 34 megawatt or 36 megawatt. Initial stage design was for 50 megawatt at 185 metric tons. Now the production is around 250 tons. The production is increased to 50%, but the power consumption has come down 50% with the various energy measures, conservation measures. We have so many cables, motors of 800 numbers, transformers of 60. And this is a scheme. We are connected with the grid at a 220 kV level, step down to 33. We have our own generation of 11 kV, step up to 33. This 33 kV level, we are connected with the grid. And we are getting steam from the captive power plant boilers, steam boilers. The main production plant requires a power, water, and steam. Power coming from captive power plant, steam is coming from captive power plant boilers, water is coming from river Godavari. So this is the connection what we have. And the philosophy is we have, for any process, we have two pumps, main pump, standby pump. One is running, other one is standby. Whenever the one pump gives trouble or goes for maintenance, the other one will run. So continuously, we are operating with the two pumps. One is working and is on standby because ours is 24/7. And we have so many equipment. Other than that, we have HRD facilities. We have 5 lecture halls. We have people to interact with students and other faculty members regularly, nearby engineering college students. And recently, TKR Engineering College, Hyderabad, students visited our factory before COVID. And faculty members from GNITS visited our factory. Some other fellow employees from other industries are visiting. We have lecture halls. We used to take them to field to explain about them, our solar plant. Only by opening doors of the components, we are explaining what is going on. This is our generator. We have kept open one transformer in dismantled mode to explain what are the internal parts. What is core, where is winding, what is tapping, we used to explain. We have one electric vehicle Reva, purchased in 2008. It is working smoothly. And all the circuit, one variety of MOCB, one circuit breaker dismantled. We have one small fountain with a solar fountain. This is one of the substation area with the beautiful slides on conservation and electrical safety. We have this. Students used to sit and enjoy for some time whenever they are coming for visit. This is our switch gear, which is maintained very nicely in one of the substation. This is our transformer yard. This is our HT switch gear area. And this is the slides what are written on walls for educating our employees and students. And we have a solar plant of 12 megawatt in 45 acres land, the inverter, the string combiner box. This is a view. And we have transformers. We have lightning rods in a solar power plant. This is automatic weather station in our solar plant to measure ambient air temperature, wind velocity, etc. We have our workshop for motors. Motors are dismantled up to 6.6 kV of 3 megawatt. We used to overhaul them. We have all the facilities here. This is the equipment what we have in our plant of DG sets, transformers, UPS, everything, VFDs. We have everything in our plant. So this is a thing what just I want to explain briefly about our plant. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
All that, I have finished my thing in allotted time.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
So shall we close now for lunch?
Yes, sir. Because next session will start on 1:30.
Yeah, after lunch at 1:30.
You are also attend this. Yes, sir. You are also attend the session. I think he also from industry persons.
Yes. Transco DGM, I will also join because I am at house. Yes. Only I will also here. Yes.
Very welcome, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you to all.
Thank you, participants. We'll meet on 1:30 p.m. today. Mm-hmm.